Good morning.
Good morning.
Hi, Kendall.
Hi. So I actually have another meeting in 5 minutes, so I'm going to make you host. You should be able to control everything, but feel free to ping me and I can hop back in if anything goes wrong.
No worries. If I'm host, I can also make others presenter, right? Yeah, I should be. Okay.
Yes, you should be able to make them co-hosts.
I'll do that. Once Phil comes. There's been some background noise at my place, water leak. So,
Oh
yeah.
no.
So I need Phil also to little bit cover if there is too much of noise, but we should be okay. We should be okay. Phil is also here.
Good morning.
Good morning. So you made me host now. Can you try making me host? I'll also make. That's a co-host.
Yes. Okay. I made Phil a co-host as well. Phil, I have to drop for another meeting in 5 minutes.
Okay.
So I have made y'all hosts, so you should be able to control everything. But if I need to hop back in, I'm happy to do that.
No worries.
Let me know when y'all are ready to admit people. There are some people in the waiting room.
Give it like 2 minutes. So I just
Okay.
need talk to Phil and then we will admit them all.
Okay.
Just a minute. Phil, can you see my screen?
Perfectly.
Okay. So as usual, we just welcome and then why we are doing this meeting pretty much. I'll try to cover this. And today's agenda is going to be, see, we can basically tell them that the previous sessions were more the vendor focus who were contributing in the community and they came and presented. And this week meeting is going to be more on developer and testing, tester focus. So we're going to have two speakers. One is from the development team. There are a couple of features that they are implementing and they would be sharing with us what they are implementing in those features, right? So that's from the development point of view. And from the testing point of view, in the community that we have been able to successfully run the 5G call with Rebecca simulator. And that team will be showing some demo for us today, what they have done with Magma 5G.
Okay.
Even though the agenda is swapped, but we will first let Samir to go in, Samir, I mean, Rebecca team to go in and present the ABOT and then the development team afterwards will go in to present the other things. After this agenda, we can let the respective teams to share their screen and they can go on with their presentation.
Okay, sounds good.
So that's pretty much. Okay, now we can admit all.
Hi, Karen.
Hello, Phil. Hello, Kader. Good morning.
Good morning. Even did you forward it to the Rebecca team? Invite?
I believe I have. Yes, I mentioned a word to Samit as well.
Yeah, if you can forward the invite, that'd be good. Don't see them here. Good morning, Andre. Bhavin, good morning.
Hi, Kara, how are you doing?
Good, Andre. Nice presentation last week. Enjoyed your speech.
Thank you very much.
You know, we should get you in a future 5G Magma meeting to present something for us.
Would be good.
So should we kickstart the call?
Sure. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to our monthly Magma 5G meeting. This is structured as an everything you need to know or ask me anything session. This morning, Cotter's going to introduce a couple of presentations that we have focused on the 5G development activities this time. The last couple of sessions, we talked about the 5G product we're developing and some issues of market or commercial deployments of it. But this morning's session will be very developer focused. So with that, I'll pass it off to Cotter so that he can introduce our speakers today.
Thank you very much, Phil. Welcome, everyone. Thanks for taking time. Just a quick reminder why we are here today. Three main agenda of this meeting. The first one is we want to make sure the developer community, like Phil mentioned, is aware of what are all the development activities as well as the testing activities that are ongoing with respect to the roadmap of 5G evolution of Magma. And the second key reason is to ensure we bring in different vendors, like Phil mentioned, and enable the collaboration between the vendors and make sure everyone gets help, the support that they need to whatever the business targets that they have and help with it, right? So those are the key targets. And we all know that the 5G is a great opportunity for us. And like Phil mentioned, today's focus is mainly going to be on the developer focus. So what we are going to do today is two things. One thing is we have been working with a company called Rebecca, who are the simulator test tool vendors, and we have been testing 4G, and we also started testing 5G, and they have been able to successfully test 5G with ABOT, whatever that we have developed, and also the future features that we are developing. So we'll give floor for Rebecca to present their product and how they have been able to successfully test Magma 5G using their product. Then we will have a Suresh and team to come and speak to us about the features that is already available in the master branch and a couple of new features that they are implementing that's going to be available in shortly, right, in November timeframe. So that's going to be the agenda and the focus of today's call. So having said that, I would like to check if the Rebecca team is here. Parthiban, can you please confirm?
Kadar, Samit is going to join. Samir looks like got stuck up somewhere. Okay. And Samit is trying to join to the Zoom. Looks like he has some difficulty. I can get started, and if Samit comes in, he can join us.
Okay, in that case, what we will do is we'll let
I think Samit was just admitted, so he's connecting audio and should be here shortly. Sorry.
Okay.
Yeah, Samit is here.
So I'll
his audio up. Audio is getting connected, Kadar. Yeah.
Sure. That's good. So I'll leave the floor for you to share the screen. Let me check if you have the presenter rights. Yeah, maybe co-host, maybe, yeah. Parthivan, you should be able to share your screen.
Yeah, thank you.
Let's make sure Samit is here before you start. Otherwise, we'll have the other team to get started.
Yes. Samit, you are in?
I'm in, yes.
Floor to you all. Go ahead.
This is all good. Yeah, we can. Hope my screen is visible to all.
Yep, we can see it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Phil. Thanks, all. Yeah, we can get started. Yes. Okay. Thank you. So we are here for an Magma 5G SA, a demo and collaboration with Rebecca Test Tool. Rebecca is a very good GNB and UE simulator, and we are going to talk about more on this. So what we have done is this, you could see here, we have a test setup in a diagrammatic way where we are putting the Magma 5G SA is going to be the system under test. And we are connecting the standard interfaces N1, N2, N3, and N6 under the test tool Rebecca. We are going to test using the simulated mode of the Rebecca's GNB and UE. And also we are going to see that the traffic is also flowing over here. And with this, we'll be able to demonstrate here the NG setup. We'll be able to see a UE registration happening and a PDU session establishment happens. And we could see that there are traffic flowing there, the TCP packets are been flowing, and we will be able to make a UE deregistration as well over here. And to say that this Magma, what we have deployed is taken from the master branch, and this is on the upcoming release 1.7. You can see here, I have put some screenshots which have been taken from the demo setup, what we have made ready for this demo. And all knows that Magma is actually a converged core, and it still holds the service and the components with its legacy names on the MME and pipeline D, session D, and subscriber DBs over there, where we have enabled the 5G features over there, which you could be seeing on the left top screenshot over here. And also for the 5G to flow between the N1 and N2 interfaces, we need the mandatory ports on the SCTP side, 38412, to be enabled. And you could see in the down screenshot, we have enabled. And this Magma 5G, what we are put it up, deployed, is also connected into an orchestrator, Magma orchestrator. And Wavelabs is kind enough to have the AWS-based deployed orchestrator ready, which we could be able to test our Magma 5G SA over there. And it's available for even the community to come and try it out. I have to mention this. Yeah. So with this, we like to move forward into the Rebecca's features and understand what Rebecca can do for us and go into a demo there. Yeah, Samit, it's all for you.
Thank you. Thank you, Parthivan. And I'd like to take an opportunity to thank Rebecca team for helping us to set up this environment in the lab and being able to successfully test Magma 5G. And I'm looking forward to really understand a little bit more about Rebecca and also see the live demo of them testing Magma 5G with their tool called ABOT. So, Samir, please go ahead.
Thank you so much, Kadir. Thanks, Parthivan, for the introduction. So, we are Rebecca Technologies. We have a test tool called ABOT, like we've been mentioning in the beginning of this demo. And the test tool has the following features that you can see on the screen. It has the capability of running 4G, 5G, as well as O-RAN test cases on platforms that support these kind of nodes. The test cases are defined in a very easy, high-level English-like language, and we follow a paradigm called behavior-driven development, BDD. And we have morphed the BDD concept to follow protocol standards. And we have come up with a grammar that can support any kind of 3GPP protocol. We are also capable of doing load simulation and multiple simultaneous access gateway UEs can be validated with different call flows. The tool is divided into two sections. One is a network tool, which actually runs the call flows and does conformance tests, does load tests, and those kind of things, and provides emulation for components that are supposed to be there in the testbed to complete the testbed. But apart from that, there are powerful features to do analytics on the testing. So we are able to collect SUT logs, system under test logs. We are able to show call flow diagrams. You're able to drill down into PCAPs and look for information to help you troubleshoot the test case, those kind of things. And we have a large set of mobility KPI and infrastructure KPI that can help you benchmark the system as well as test it. So the tool, once the test cases have been run, has a machine learning capability to learn from the test cases. And it also tells you about the coverage of your testing. So the machine learning tool is capable of understanding 3GPP procedures, different types of 3GPP procedures, and it can give those kind of statistics. It has a feature called storyboard, and all in all, it will help you do a root cause analysis of failures after a round of testing. And of course, this tool has an extensive REST API, and you can also integrate it with a CI/CD system. Can we go to the next slide? Thanks. So this is a brief of the user interface. So you have test execution artifact samples in the form of ladder diagram, logs. The logs are not just logs that you capture and show. The logs are organized according to places in the call flow. So you don't have to browse through large logs and figure out which part of the call flow you're in. You can click on the ladder diagram and you can go to a particular place in the log. Those kind of features are there. We have infrastructure KPIs. We use the Prometheus node infrastructure, node exporter architecture. And of course, PCAP details, which you would otherwise see in Wireshark, you can use the tool to browse the same. To the next slide, please. So those were the artifacts that you saw. And this is the analytics view that I was just describing in the first slide. This has the procedure details. It's like a test manager's view. So you will be able to look at the coverage of your testing. You will be able to figure out which 3GPP procedures you have covered in the testing. You will be able to select a time range for which the testing has been done. And it's presented to you in a manner of a dashboard. We have the storyboard feature, which is like an English, like a narration of all the testing that has happened over a period of time. Then we have execution window, which gives you feedback on the executing test case. And of course, infrastructure and mobility KPI analytics, which are relevant from a 3GPP perspective. So I think we're now ready to get into the demo. Parthivan, you can please take over.
Thank you, Sumit. I'm excited to see the A-Bot working with Magma 5G. Looking forward to it.
Yes, thank you for this opportunity. Appreciate working with Wave Labs, with the Magma initiative.
Thank you for supporting the Magma community. That's with your tools, we are able to build a better Magma 5G open source. That's really good. Parthivan, are you still there? Want to share the screen?
Yes, sir. Yes, Kadar. Is my screen visible or do I have to reshare? I'm not sure.
Yeah, we are still seeing the presentation.
Oh, okay. Give me a minute, please. Okay. Now you could see a player over here.
Yeah. Yes, we can see.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, let's get started with the demo. We have did a pre-recording of the demo for just to avoid some network glitches over here. We could love to do a live demo, but just for everyone's convenience, we have done a pre-recording. And let me give some background on where the setup lies in. We have did the, as I was mentioning during the presentation, we have taken the master branch code, which is now very healthy enough where community could go ahead and try doing the Magma 5G trials now. It's yet to get into official because we are doing some more hardening over there. We are trying to make it more better, improving on the code quality. That's where Wavelabs is committed to test it out on various test tools. And one such is with Rabaka, which is very good enough to test everything over here. Okay, and said that, and Magma 5G in our Wavelabs connectivity lab, it's now deployed on top of an OpenStack private data center. And these VMs are brought up on OpenStack virtualization layer, and these are deployed. And we have an Rabaka again on another VM instance and Magma Access Gateway in and one of the instance. And first, as a first step, we like to test the services up and running, particularly on the three key services, which are the Magma's MME service as a first step. You could see that we are verifying that the services are up and running as a first step. And next goes with the session D, which is actually translating to 5G as an SMF. First was the AMF, then the SMF. We like to see this service availability within the Magma Access Gateway. Then the pipeline D, which translates to the UPF within the Magma 5G. And we verify that these services are up and running as the first step. And once we do this, then the next step is for us to go and see, is this the port which are responsible, the SCTP ports are live, up and ready for the N1, N2 interface messages to be connected with the Rabaka Gnode B simulations, simulator tool, test tool. And once we have done this, we want to add a subscriber here live, and we want to show that we are able to make a call using the new subscriber which are getting added here. That's where we are into the NMS dashboard. This is Magma's orchestrator. And we are adding the subscriber with an MC value ends at 5 as the value. Yeah, we have given the same subscriber name and the MC value as there. And these are the auth key and the OPC values, which has to be configured and matching with the UE. And so we have made sure we are using the same values which are being configured in the UE from the Rabaka test tool UE simulator. And we have added that into our NMS through NMS. And we have selected the default APN. And we are now trying to save and add the subscriber over here from the NMS dashboard. See that you could be able to see that the MC ending with 5 value has been getting added, and it's been successfully added here. And we go back to Magma Access Gateway terminal, and we want to verify that the whatever we added in NMS is being percolated down to the Access Gateway. We are verifying that over the CLI command, that the subscriber CLI commands are available, where we could see the subscriber database, and we verified it's available, it came down there. And now we are getting started to test on it. As a first step, we go with the NG setup, Samit. It's all about, yes. Can you please little give more details on this?
Sure. So we are now seeing the NG setup test case. As you can see, the high level English-like language. And we're now executing that test case, which is to set up the NG setup procedure between the AMF and the Gnode B. So we are now seeing the execution view. You get transaction counts, uplink, downlink bandwidth, and packet counts organized by protocol to view the health of the test case as it is executing. The capsules on top are color-coded in normal colors, so green, suggesting that the test cases are passing properly. And once we're done, the execution area refreshes and you can see what happened during the test case. And you can see healthy counts for the NG setup packets. And now we're going to the artifacts area where we will drill down further into this test case. And we can go into the packet captures, which we'll be selecting now. And we can see the call flow. And we can see the IP addresses of the Gnode B and the AMF that have been used. And the PCAPs, you can browse them out of the abort tool itself instead of going to Wireshark. You could, of course, always go to Wireshark and view the packets as well, it's being done right now. And applying the NGAP filter, and we see the NG setup request and response between the G0B and the AMF. So this is the first test case that we run, and we can also have other powerful features like collecting the SUT logs. This is the AMF log collected from the system under test, and you can analyze that log to see what happened when the test case was executed. So this is a powerful troubleshooting feature that we have. So now we are running the next test case. So this is an initial registration followed by a PDU session establishment. So we will do a little bit more than the NG setup. We will actually be registering a UE with the AMF. And the execution window comes up again while we are executing, and transaction counts, uplink, downlink bandwidth, and packet counts organized by protocol. So now we see a lot more packets on the NGAP front. And we also see that there are HTTP v2 packets, as this test is more complex than the first one. And we can see that the capsules are green at the top, suggesting that the test case is executing and is now finished. And once done, we will again analyze and go to the artifacts area right after. You can see the packet counts, and they're organized by the packet names, message names, sorry. And we now drill down again into this test case, and we look at the packet capture view, and we see a much more complex call flow, which is the registration call flow, and again, the PCAP. And we can see the pickup at different parts of the call flow. So you don't have to go back and forth and try to figure out. And again, you can also do the same thing with Wireshark if you prefer that. And now if we filter with NGAP, we see the complete registration procedure. So this is, the abort tool has now behaved like a G0B and executed two test cases. And you can see the registration call flow, authentication, security mode, registration accept, and then followed by a PDU session establishment. And like the last time, we can again view the SUT logs and see what happened while the call flow executed. And you can analyze, and if you keep going, and you'll be able to see your code execution as part of the abort tool, and how it will help you to figure out what is happening. So here we get a PDU session establishment accept, suggesting that all went well. So now let's take a little brief look at the analytics section. So this is the machine learning piece that I was talking about. And it has filters, and you can filter with respect to time. And we are actually filtering out only the two test cases that we ran just now. And these are the two feature files that we ran. And that was the NG setup. And the machine learning software organizes all the 3GPP procedures that it sees. And you can get views of the different types. So this is the test manager's view. And information, you will be able to make a decision as to whether your system under test is ready to go to production. So the dashboard has procedures, scenarios, protocols, configurations, interfaces, and all of these are measuring the quality and the coverage of your testing. So with that, we come to the end of this demo, and I hand it back to Parthivan and Kadir for further.
Thank you, yeah. Parthivan, do you have anything to say more?
Yeah, thank you, Samit. Thanks, Kadar, for the opportunity. Yeah, if any questions, any Q and questions from any of the community members, we have, I believe we have a couple of minutes, we could take it up. If not, we can pass it on to you, Kadar.
Thank you. And if anyone has questions, please feel free to type it in the chat. We'd be happy to answer towards the end. Like Phil mentioned early in this call, today it's going to be mostly the developer-focused session. And next monthly meeting, we're going to have two awesome companies and coming and presenting what they are doing with Magma open source community. I'm looking forward to that meeting. The names of the company is a little bit, I would like to keep it as a surprise for the next meeting. So with that, what I would like to do now is hand over the session to the community who is building a 5G code base on top of the Magma platform, open source. So let me see who requires the presentation rights. Suresh, you or anyone else?
Yeah, I can do that, Kadir.
Sure, let me see if I can give you the presentation rights. I will find you in the participant, Suresh. Okay, got it.
The today attendance is big, and I think you need to search to find out.
Yeah, I mean, thank you.
Yeah, I think I'm able to share now.
Sure. So what Suresh is planning to do is share what is already been done and available in the master branch and a couple of features that they are implementing. The implementation is ongoing right now. What they are implementing and why they are implementing. So Suresh, please go ahead. Floor is all yours.
Yeah, thanks, Kadar. So there's a development update we are giving every month over the last 3 months. Some of these items are known to the people who are regular attendees here. However, for the benefit of everyone, the first part I'm repeating, and then the new features that are coming up, I will also talk about those. The features that are available out of Magma 5G code base in the master branch of Magma open source with respect to 5G standalone are UE registration and deregistration, and the service via CPE, idle mode and paging, and then as such, basic authentication is now ready. However, the 5G standards compliant SUPI registration is something that we are going to discuss today in this call. And the code base is available in this repo. You can try out. And the features that are in development in Q4 2021 are usage reporting and charging. We're hoping sometime in the month of November, the feature will be available for trials. Dynamic policy support and 5G QoS, both these features also will be available in Q4. IPv6 support also is available in this quarter. And as such, all these PRs are under review. Anytime this month and next month, these PRs will be landing in the master branch. Okay, so with that, I take a quick moment to give a small view into the roadmap we have for Q4 and H1 2022. See, in Q4, the QoS feature that the way it is implemented has multiple QoS classes, and network initiated session modification is another feature coming in through policy support. I mean, dynamic policy support. With that, network initiated QoS classes also will be part of Magma. And as part of the hardening exercise we are undertaking in Q4, we are coming up with scale tests on a given Magma box of 4 cores and 4 GB RAM, 600 UEs that are connected to 12 GNBs, and 400 Mbps uplink downlink throughput is what we are targeting to achieve in Q4. And feature parity with 4G FWA is another feature we are targeting. However, it may be delayed a bit, may not be available in Q4 2021 because it will have to go through a lot of stability testing. It may be available tentatively as of now, but not confident about it. In first half of 2022, basic slicing foundations are targeted, and slice instance onboarding related designs are in progress right now. And once the slice instance is onboarded, the subscribers that are in the given operator domain will be mapped to particular slice instances. And Magma is adopting a certain approach to bring in this slicing feature into Magma. As most of you who are part of the community know, Magma follows the minimalist approach. The features and the requirements that the community are looking for, or the operators are looking for, we target to implement those features rather than trying to comply with everything that is there in the 3GPP specifications. So as part of these slicing foundations, the rate limiting and then the session management related data elements in the session D also will be transformed to have slice configuration or slice related data elements in the data structures. So that's the style we are adopting. And in early 2022, AMF to AMF communication will be enabled, wherein the admission control for every variety of slice type also will be fully implemented. So that is the high level view into the slicing feature, the way we are implementing. So with that, I hand over the control to my team member, Yogesh. He will talk through the 5G QoS, the way it is getting implemented in Magma. Yogesh, can you take over?
Yeah, Suresh, thanks. So you will have the control, right? Maybe I can just, as part of QoS support, already there are things which are in place. All the basic QoS are already there in place. We are extending the support more to the dynamic and the PCF related features. So multiple QoS classes, static and dynamic, where static is already there. We're in the process of enhancing it for the dynamic support. In Q4, we are mainly targeting for the APN-based, but in 2022 H1, we will enhance our policy infrastructure to support slicing as well. As part of dynamic policy, we have developed the N7 interface. We are using the some stub pieces to test our code. The target is to have it integrated with either the open source or the tools like Abbott for having end-to-end test. So that means it will enable us to support the dynamic policies. We will also support QoS profile changes through session modification. So once the session is established through PCF and N7, we can change the QoS that is applied. Also, we are going to support this GTP extension in OVS for both IPv4 and IPv6, where it's going to support QFI, so that the feature is implemented from PCF to the OVS. So there are things in place, but we have to make sure that it works for all the existing combinations, including the 4G. So some of the flows which we are going to develop are QoS identifier, which is 5QI based, and allocation and retention priority. I think allocation and retention priority is already there. Also, we are going to enhance to support GBR QoS flow, which will have the guaranteed bitrate both for uplink, downlink, and maximum flow bitrate both for uplink and downlink. Non-GBR QoS flow, that is the session-based Ember, that is already present as part of the master branch. However, it is undergoing some scale and stability test. So I hope by end of November, or the initial set of tests will be done. So this is the high level US plan, and just to give an overview on how the QFI extension we are going to do in OVS and then into the data path, so that all the QFI is supported. So the session set, which is on the top left, that is a session SMF is going to configure PipeLine D. So PipeLine D is a UPF in our case. That's going to configure the session with the required QFIs. So then we are going to support the QFI in the uplink and the downlink. The QFIs will then be sent to Rio controller. Then Rio controller, using the OpenFlow messages, is going to install QFI in the OVS data path. And once the QFI is installed in the data path, the traffic can directly use the OVS data path, the GTP traffic, in both the uplink and the downlink direction. And it can serve the QoS rules which has been configured. This slide shows how the QoS can be from the top level, how the QoS information percolates all down to the PipeLine D. So this is the non-federated gateway. Here, the policies are coming to the orchestrator. And then from orchestrator, through the streamer and policy assignment controller, the information is passed on to the policy DB. And policy DB then either using local session manager or Redis-based root store, which is on the right-hand side, it's going to interact with session D, which then will configure the required policies onto an existing session. And the session is going to configure PipeLine D. And then again, this flow will percolate down to OVS and the data path. And of course, we have communication. Session D will have communication with AMF for all the flows which are going towards the UE. We have certain other flows like session proxy responder, central session controller. So basically, these are boiling down to how the session information is exchanged, how the messages are converted from an open API to the local gRPC messages. So this is an overview of non-federated mode. Again, coming to the PCF extension, what we are developing right now. So as part of PCF extension, we are going to send the N7 messages. This N7 messages via a notification handler will be converted into, so these N7 messages are basically the regular 3GPP messages, where we are going to convert into the gRPC messages via an N7 proxy, which is shown on the top end. This whole infrastructure lies in the federated gateway. From N7 proxy via a session proxy responder, this call flow is going to end up into the FEG relay. And this FEG relay lies in the orchestrator, which is on the left-hand side orange box. So N7 proxy is going to send messages to the FEG relay, which is the gRPC messages. And then FEG relay via a policy assignment controller streamer is going to the policy DB, which will configure all the rules which needs to be configured. So these rules will be the dynamic rules, which will then go to session D via a local session manager or the Redis rule, based on the configuration that has been chosen. And then it is the same as the federated, the non-federated gateway. Some calls will be sent to AMF or to the pipeline based on is it going to send towards the UE for all session modification, session acceptance, and assuming everything is fine, then this whole information is then configured on the pipeline onto the OES. I have not gone through all the flows, but yeah, just to give an high level, these are the, because this is a dynamic policy, so there is some information which is going to go up from session D towards PCF. So like some arrows like the central session controller, session for the responder, these are going to convey these messages or get some information towards session map between session D and PCF. Yeah, I think so. That's concluding the Fed gateway, federated port. So this is the high-level call flow, which we are planning to. I think most of the pieces are all there. So PCF is going to post the policy control update message. It's going to land onto the Fed SPI. From there, this update is going to N7 proxy. This N7 proxy is going to convert these messages into the local gRPC message. Then via policy reauth call flow, this is going to land into the Fed relay. And from Fed relay, again, this policy reauth call flow will go to session D. And then the session D, either we'll send messages to pipeline D or SMF to configure the sessions based on this intent if things are accepted by UE. And similarly, the response will be propagated back from session D down towards PCF. So this is the high level call flow, both in the federated, non-federated mode. And this is the PCF design, which we are working on right now. Maybe I think as discussed, we can take some take the questions in the last, or you can post the questions.
Thanks, Yogesh. That was a great explanation of how QoS feature is getting implemented in the community. Thanks a lot for that. Just a time check, right? So we have 17 minutes more. I just want to make sure that we leave 5 more minutes to answer some of the questions in the chat. So Suresh, if you want to take it to the next feature that you wanted to explain, please do
so. Yeah, I think we have a reasonable amount of time. I think Anusha can go the SUSE deconcealment approach adopted in Magma. Anusha?
Yeah, yes, Suresh.
All yours.
Thank you, Suresh. Hello, everyone.
Your voice is a little feeble. If you can adjust your microphone, it'll be better.
Okay. Is it fine, Suresh, now?
Yeah, perfect.
Okay, fine, Suresh. So I'll take you through the procedure, through the SUSE deconcealment implementation approach here. So basically, 3GPP has defined the subscriber identity protection for 5G networks. So UE can encrypt the identity before sending it over the air interface. So this identifier, which we are mentioning it as SUSE, conceals the SUPE. So there is a procedure on how the SUPE is transformed to SUSE in UE. So UE has to provision with the home network public key identifiers and the public key and the protection scheme. Okay, so before going to protect all these attributes, so the 3GPP specs has come up with an encryption scheme, which is elliptic curve integrated encryption scheme to be used for all this secure exchange of data. So UE should be provisioned with the home network public key identifiers, public key, and the protection scheme that is going to use to encrypt the data. So all this data operator should provision it. And similarly, like operator should also provision the public private key pair and also the home network public key identifier, which is used to refer the unique public private key pair and the protection scheme used by these pairs to encrypt the data. So UE uses the home network public key and the protection scheme and encrypts the data. So apart from this encryption output, there are a couple of identifiers which SUSE carries where these identifiers are used in the core network to deconcile the SUSE. So as you see here in the presentation, SUSE consists of type home network identifier routing indicator scheme and home network public key ID. So the type defines about is it of MC or network access identifier, and home network identifier represents a PLM. Routing indicator is used to locate the user database, subscriber database. According to the specs, protection scheme supports profile A, profile B, and null scheme. Null scheme represents that the identity is not encrypted. The public key identifier is used to identify unique public private key pair in the core network, which is where we extract the private key and deconcile the concealed identity. The protection scheme output, this is the main part where we get the cryptograph data and also the ephemeral public key, which UE generates. So we have added, Magma, we have added the support to exchange the concealed identities and deconceal the encrypted identity. So subscriber DB of the AGW maintains a list of home network public key identifiers. In order to provision it, we have exposed an API in Orchestrator to configure multiple SUSE profiles where it accepts public key identifier, a key pair, and the protection scheme. We have also introduced a deconciling function as a part of subscriber DB, which holds an algorithm to decrypt the SUSE using the private key. And this also has the access to the list of key pairs that is provisioned by the operator. So we have defined an approach on how the orchestrator populates this data to AGW. And to operate AGW in headless mode, we have also provided an CLI utility to feed the list of public private key pairs to subscriber DB. As you see in the diagram, in Magma, AGW fetches the list of subscribers from Orchestrator using the gRPC API. So we made use of the existing Orchestrator Cloud RPC servicer to also populate the profiles data that is configured by the operator using MMS and Orchestrator APIs. So we store all this data in subscriber DB like an in-memory data. It was not placed anywhere in the DB in AGW. And this in-memory data can be configured using Orchestrator. In case of headless mode, this in-memory data can be fed with using the CLI utility that is available in the AGW. So new gRPC APIs are also added here. So where AMF uses those APIs to decrypt the data, and it can also feed with the necessary info like what is at home network public key identifier and the complete scheme output, whatever I have represented in the earlier slide, which contains the encrypted data, ephemeral public key, and home network public key identifier, and the protection scheme. So the SUSE decryption request is filled with all of this data, whereas SIDF and the in-memory data. SIDF contacts in-memory data and extracts a private key, and this SIDF, which is the deconcealment function, holds the algorithm to decrypt the entity and returns a UVMSIN value back to the AMM. So this is the approach we have implemented in Magma to store the public-private key pairs and to deconsider the SUSE. So in the next slide, we'll explain about the procedures, mostly what I have already specified there. After receiving the initial UE registration request, AMF, based on the SUSE type identity and the protection scheme, it requests the decryption request to subscriber DB, where the SIDF holds an algorithm to deconsolidate and return back the UE MSIN. So from there on, the standard procedures continues as it is. So this part explains about the deconcealment of the SUSE here.
This is great. So, thanks, Anusha. Kadir, back to you.
Yeah, thank you. Can you go to the next slide, please? Thank you, Anusha, Yokesh, Suresh, for explaining. So the intention of that call was to really ensure that we are able to provide what is existing today that you can already experiment right out in your lab, and what are all the additional features that are coming in the roadmap, and the practical explanation of a couple of features, how it is getting implemented inside this Magma code base and Magma architecture. And I also would like to say that, you know, we have in the community, we have a orchestrator that is available for free. If you click the next one, Suresh, thank you. The orchestrator is available for free. If you wanted to try out, a 5G access gateway connecting to this orchestrator, please feel free to reach out to us in the 5G support channel in the Slack. We'd be happy to set it up. And I know that already three or four, community members, individual/companies are using this to experiment 5G, and we have been supporting them. We'll be happy to do for those who are interested to, experiment the A gateway for 5G, right? Magma for 5G. Next slide, please. Yeah, time for Q&A. Phil, let's look at if there are any questions. You still have 9 minutes.
Yeah, thanks, Kadir. I see a couple of questions that we can take off the chat really quickly, and there are three of the first four are related to Docker. And let me just say, today, the access gateway is deployed as a set of regular Linux services packaged together in a single runtime. But as part of the 1.7 release, we will be offering a Docker deployment option for the access gateway itself. It's the dev environment that requires Docker today on the access gateway side. The orchestrator part of Magma is delivered as a Kubernetes package. And of course, you need a container runtime underneath your Kubernetes environment, which is often Docker or Containerd, depending on where you're at with that Kubernetes deployment. So those we can take right off the top. I want to look at the question on security procedures, whether they're turned on or turned off. Today, the 5G security procedures are actually set to null. We have them turned off as we're developing basic capabilities. And I think Anusha talked about some of the work that we're doing to bring some of the security and privacy features back into Magma. Let's see. Continuing down the list, does Magma include alpha narrowband IoT features under the Magma project or expected in its roadmap? There is narrowband IoT work going on in Magma. It's a roadmapped feature. They're not included in anything deployable today. But if you want to follow the work on narrowband IoT, there is a channel in the Magma Slack called Project NB IoT, where the work that's going on to develop that is being tracked, and you can ask specific questions about narrowband today. Cotter, I'm going to pass it back to the Wave Labs team to answer the question about the 5G AWG running on a VM on top of OpenStack. You're muted.
Yeah, the question is more of the demo, what was shown, the 5G gateway, was it running in container? Was it running in VM, right? So the question was it running in container? The answer was provided that it is running in the VM on top of the OpenStack. There is one more question is there. This is more related to the roadmap, Phil. The integration of Magma with external control plane, elements like UDM, NRF, SSSF.
Yeah, so right now, we don't have definitive projects put together for integration with the rest of the 5G standalone features directly. There is a activity going on related to network slicing where the NSSF would be required, but I can't point to definitive project plans to have that integrated. Right now, resource discovery, the NRF, is not really very interesting because there's not a lot of resources to discover the way things are constructed, and our validation of subscriber management is done internally. So integration with an external UDM is not something that we have on the current roadmap, although it's certainly something we would take up community support to work on.
Thank you, Phil. There is also NSSF, and I know that Suresh and the team in the community just said that they're working on design of network slicing features.
Yes.
So, Suresh, do you want to comment on the question? Is in the roadmap the integration of Magma with external control plane elements that's more specific to NSSF? What is our plan? Are we going to work with external NSSF, or NSSF will be an embedded functions within the Magma orchestrator?
Yeah, we today are trying to add the basic slice instance onboarding through the Magma orchestrator. Integration with an Uber orchestrator is something that we are not considering as an immediate option in H1 2022, because once the basic slice instance onboarding is complete, we want to see the QoS and also the rate limiting features are stable, and then subsequently we'll adopt integration with third party NSSFs. So at least in H1 2022, we will not have the luxury to think of integration with third parties.
Thank you, Suresh. Louis, thanks for projecting IoT Magma. That's more NB-IoT is on more on the 4G branch, right? Thank you so much again for asking that question. We have one more question, maybe the last one for today, and then we'll have a quick closing statement. The question is from Vishnu Ram. Could you talk a bit about UPF testing and integration and its maturity? This is more for our testing team, Ankur, Parthiban, or, Samir.
Or Yogesh. Oh.
Yogesh, yeah. Someone from the community want to address this, please?
Yeah, I can share a start of this, and maybe Yogesh can add it. So for the UPF testing, we are trying to test on the throughput scalability, trying to test on the different various throughput levels that's been in our cards, and we are already doing it. We are trying to do that with different test tools as well. We right now are trying to do with Rebecca. We are trying to do that with other licensing tools as well, which are available in our labs. And this is also includes the scaling test, which includes the UE scaling as well as the throughput scaling. Yogesh, you want to talk particularly on the bandwidth and throughput related stuff?
Yeah, meaning I think we have a proven OVS code base where we have some benchmark number for the number of new patches per second, the bandwidth rate. I think same will still continue on 5G. We are trying to see how we can enhance it. So the basic, we have this OVS support and we have benchmark with Inspire and other tools as part of the mentioned. So 4G is already benchmarked, 5G we are in the process, especially with the slicing and the QoS feature. So we will share the report, but all the initial test looks good. I hope this answers the question.
It does, Yogesh. Thanks a lot. And I'd like to say thank you to everyone for joining. And today's session, as we set the context early, is going to be a complete developer-focused session. In our next session, we will have a couple of community partners who are adopting the Magma, coming and sharing their experiences, adopting the Magma into their own ecosystem. Thanks all again for joining. Phil, if you want to have a final closing. Please.
Yeah, thanks, Cutter. I don't have anything else to add other than thank you for everyone who's come to join us today. I want to give my usual plugs for the project Slack channel activity as the best place to get in contact with our community and the developers and users of Magma. And I want to thank everyone for spending an hour of their day with us. So have a great day. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Phil. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you. Great presentation. Thanks.
Thank you, Doug.
Thank you. Thank you, Doug. Thank you all.
Thanks, Kadar.
Thank you, Suresh, Parthiban, Yokesh, Anuksha. Thank you very much. Also from Rebecca, Samit, Samir, thank you very much.
Thank you, Kavya. Thank you. Bye.